Peace, let us pray to the Lord. Father, on this holy night, your Son, our Saviour, was born in human flesh. Renew your church as the body of Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In this holy night, there was no room for your Son in the inn. Protect with your love those who have no home and all who live in poverty. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In this holy night, Mary, in the pain of labour, brought your Son to birth. Hold in your hand all who are in pain or distress. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In this holy night, your Christ came as a light shining in the darkness. Bring comfort to all who suffer in the sadness of our world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In this holy night, the angels sang peace to God's people on earth. Strengthen those who work for peace and justice in all the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In this holy night, shepherds in the field heard good tidings of joy. Give us grace to preach the gospel of Christ's redemption. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In this holy night, strangers found the Holy Family and saw the baby lying in the manger. Bless our homes and all whom we love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In this holy night, heaven is come down to earth, and earth is raised to heaven. Hold in your hand all those who have passed through death in the hope of your coming kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Christians the world over celebrate Christ's birth. Open our hearts and minds that he may be born in us today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, in this holy night, angels and shepherds worshipped at the manger throne. Receive the worship we offer in fellowship with Mary, Joseph, and all the saints, through him who is your word made flesh, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. This is a holy time, a time where there is both comfort and joy. And in this holy time, we are faced with a great contrast. The mighty emperor, Caesar Augustus, the most powerful man of that age, the ruler of the vast Roman Empire, gives an order and everyone has to obey. Throughout his empire, everyone had to get themselves enrolled in the tax registers so that there would be enough taxes collected to finance the emperor's many needs, to finance and expand his military power, to lay down the great network of roads and aqueducts throughout the Roman Empire, and to construct great palaces, theatres, baths, and stadiums. In comparison, how trivial it would seem in the eyes of the world to be that couple in the obscure village of Nazareth in Galilee. Mary and Joseph obeyed the imperial command and set out to enroll in the tax registers of Joseph's hometown of Bethlehem. They were quite insignificant. Not only was there no imperial palace at their disposal, there was not even room for them in the local inn. They had to make do with a stable for Mary to give birth. But notice, at this time, all over the world, people gather, not to celebrate the Emperor Augustus Caesar, because it is not Augustus Caesar who brings comfort and joy. No, we gather to celebrate that birth of an infant in a manger in the little town of Bethlehem. For it is not the emperor dressed in the finest robes who is the real lord of the world, but rather the little baby wrapped in swaddling cloths. The names of the Roman emperors, like those of other great men and women of the world, have long passed away and are little remembered. Yet everywhere on earth, the birth of this child is remembered with joy. On that holy night in Bethlehem, then, the prophecy of Isaiah was fulfilled. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Upon those who dwell in the land of gloom, a light has shone. That light is Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Saviour of the world, and it is he who brings comfort and joy. When we contemplate the mystery of Christmas, that God so loved the world that he sent his only Son to redeem it, that he who was in the form of God emptied himself and took the form of a slave, that the eternal Word, who was with God, who was God, became flesh and dwelt among us, we cannot help but be filled with wonder and awe. We become like the shepherds and the magi. All we can do is approach the mystery in adoration. This event surpasses all human knowledge. St. Thomas Aquinas wrote, "Of all the works of God, this surpasses reason more than any other, since one cannot conceive of God doing anything more wonderful than that the true God, the Son of God, should be made a true man." Do Do we not express our reverence for this great mystery every time we recite the Nicene Creed? And some of us will bow to express that reverence as we say the words, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. By becoming man, God has, in a certain way, united himself with every human person. He has brought to each of us great comfort and great joy. He has revealed to us the truth about who he is love. He has revealed to us also that every human being has dignity, including the unborn child, the poor, the outcast, the suffering, and the dying. By becoming man, God came to earth to deliver us from sin and death. He came to make all things new, to bring about the new creation. He took on our human nature so that we might become partakers of his divine nature, that we become sharers in the life of the Blessed Trinity. The fathers and doctors of the Church speak of the Christmas mystery as a wonderful exchange between God and man. He takes what is ours so that he may give us what is his. In sending his Son, God has opened for us a share in his divine life, the power, St. John says, to become children of God. St. Francis of Assisi was so moved by the mystery of Christmas that he began the custom of the Christmas crib, except that he did it using live people. His love for poverty led him to this special appreciation of the wonder of that first Christmas. One of his great followers, St. Bonaventure, wrote the following: "The King of Kings and Lord of Lords has become the slave and humble servant of men. God, supremely glorious, dwelling in the heights of majesty, has dwelt in a lowly manger." At this time, we do not gather to honour or to worship the powerful emperor. We gather to honour and to worship the infant wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger, the one announced by the angel as the Saviour, who is Christ the Lord. We worship him who gives meaning and so intelligibility to our lives, who offers us eternal life and salvation, who brings us comfort and joy, even now as we endure the darkness of the COVID pandemic. In becoming man, he has brought eternity to us, and so we live as a people of hope. This virtue of hope is truly a virtue of Christmas, a virtue that should distinguish our lives as followers of Jesus. In the midst of so much anxiety and despair in our world, may we be witnesses of Christian hope. So, as we gather to worship and adore the baby Jesus, may this Jesus, born at Bethlehem, bless you and your loved ones with his love and peace, and may he bring to you true and lasting comfort and joy.
Oh, God.
May the Father, who has loved the eternal Son from before the foundation of the world, shed that love upon you, his children. Amen. May Christ, who by his incarnation gathered into one things earthly and heavenly, fill you with joy and peace. Amen. May the Holy Spirit, by whose overshadowing Mary became the God-bearer, give you grace to carry the good news of Christ. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.